This box, right here, it holds one of the unsung heroes of Hollywood production, the tool that makes War Machine soup look like it's actually there. It's a method that started with a teapot and became ubiquitous. It's an essential part of a VFX film set, but it's not a camera or a green screen. You have to search hard to see it in behind the scenes videos. But this is not just a gazing ball that I bought for $20.99. It's a key to making virtual objects look real.
In this scene, I was behind one of the pillars. My name's Leo Bovell. I'm a VFX supervisor at Tryptyc. Been in the industry now for over 17 years. So I've been at it quite a while. In this scene, basically, Abraham, the statue and everything, we basically had to replace it, obviously.
Cut for them is like action for you in this situation. And you're like, I have to scramble to get as many references as possible.
Right between takes, I get in and I do as much as I can, and then I get out of there. There are times where you can't get in between takes because the creatives, they're in such a groove, they just got to keep going.
One of the big problems VFX artists face in The Handmaid's Tale, Marvel movies, everything, is matching fake stuff to real light. And Leo scrambled in the real Lincoln Memorial during the shoot because that information was crucial to create a realistic-looking Lincoln Memorial from scratch. As you can see in this BTS from Mavericks VFX, he used an HDRI to figure out how to make it look so real. A high dynamic range image. You might have an HDR option on your phone. It helps photos to look less blown out in really bright spots. An HDRI captures data in a high dynamic range. A normal photo might look like this. You can't see anything, any detail or data near the sun, or any trees in the shadows. Using high dynamic range fixes that by meshing different exposures, different pictures of a scene to let you see all the detail. Shadowy mush turns into visible trees, and the sun becomes clear again. Computer software can take that HDRI and use all that data to figure out how light works in a scene. Make that a 360-degree panorama, and you have enough data to simulate the light in a mini world. Now you can add an object to that world, and it will look like the real light is hitting it, with all the right highlights, shadows, and reflections. HDRI is either used to light the object or as a reference for VFX artists when they light it on their own using manually added lights, making a bunch of tweaks and adjustments. How does that HDR help you when you're actually off of this crazy shoot day and you have to make something from it?
If we've captured the light on that day and then we take that light, we put it into the computer, we get immediate feedback without trying to guess. The HDR really helps at the stage where we are realistically applying shaders and materials to emulate the marble.
Getting an accurate HDRI really quickly is what causes all that scrambling on shoot days. The first HDRIs actually used stuff like this. Gazing balls, Christmas ornaments, anything that was round and shiny and could help them get a panorama. The idea is that the picture of the gazing ball gets unwrapped into a 360-degree picture when you put it in the right software.
I'm gonna start taking some photos, and that's gonna help us capture all the light in this scene and get it in this panorama.
This reflective ball is one of three main ways that people do it. Sometimes people will rotate their camera or use a lens that's really wide. VFX supervisors like Leo might also use a 360-degree camera to snag these images really quickly because they're in the middle of a hectic situation.
I used a Theta. It's a 360 camera and it's very small, so it's not intrusive. With the Theta, usually it's a couple of seconds. If you're doing a chrome ball, so you have to set up a tripod, you have to put the ball down, that's a couple of minutes. This is where the Theta makes all the difference in the world because it's such a tiny device and you just plop it down and you get in and get out. When I'm just shooting bracketed with the 8mm lens, probably a minute. Right between takes, I get in and I do as much as I can, and then I get out of there.
HDR is so mainstream now that I can plop it into editing software and make an HDR photo. I took some video without the chrome ball in it, so I put my 3D image in there. You see, without the light, it looks fake. Add the HDRI though, and boom, suddenly it's like it's there. Do you see the reflection of the trees or how the sun is glinting off of it? Using a real environment to light a 3D object started with work like this teapot. See the windows reflecting in it? In the 90s, researcher Paul Debevec and colleagues pioneered the creation of HDRIs for multiple images, and then using those to light 3D scenes. Without them, back in the late 90s, it was a lot harder. As his paper says, currently available techniques for realistically rendering synthetic objects into scenes are labor-intensive and not always successful. They had to position lights, copy reference photos, and program in reflections. People still have to do some of that, but you can also let HDRI light objects in your scene. Today, repositories of HDRIs let you download images and simulate thousands of environments, like an old room or outside a small cathedral. This lighting often still comes from a ball like this one, but VFX artists don't use that extra time just to chill out. They use it to work harder. As this person who's thinking about light like exponentially more than the normal person, would you rather hang out with Rembrandt or Newton?
Maybe Rembrandt, but ultimately, if I threw another name in there, it would be Degas.
Why Degas?
Because he was just obsessive about his artwork. Him constantly chasing perfection is something that I think drives a lot of artists and also intrigues me at the same time. It is a national monument and slash park. Because of that, we couldn't limit the public from entering the space. It was an insane day. I mean, you had fans who showed up on the day. You had some people who thought it was a protest, so they showed up. Again, they couldn't close the set, so people started to actually sneak in to some of the shots and pose, because on the day we had about roughly 150 actors. So you had a couple of fans started to sneak in, but obviously their outfits, their garments, something just looked off. So sometimes some of them actually got into the shoot and it was like, wait a minute, something's off here. Let's get you out of here.